So joining us for the review of the statewide vote on Proposal 1, tomorrow for the topic of our forum is Roads for Tomorrow or Tomorrow for Better Roads. And obviously the subject is Proposal 1. I've got a little red eye this morning, staying up to watch the polls. I don't know if others have. Yes. So it's just been a real whirlwind for our folks who are panelists here today. I so appreciate their standing up and being brave to be the first ones on a panel discussion. Roger Martin of Martin Waymar is here. Gilda Jacobs of the Michigan League for Public Policy. Randall Thompson for the Coalition Against Higher Taxes and Special Interest Deals. And Craig Thiel of Citizens Research Council. You know, it's so funny, this past weekend we had a Kentucky Derby, and one of the first questions I get often when I'm on a panel and it comes discussion time is, where are you from? And I'm from Louisville, Kentucky, and as I speak with you today, I can hear my accent just flowing out there. I typically have the professional, you know, diction and then the home, you know, the home accent, so pardon me. I have to put up with your accents, right? So let me introduce our panelists, and then what I'm going to ask them to do is speak one after another, and so I'll take a seat, and then when they've completed their presentations or their comments, their remarks to you, then we'll open it up for questions and discussion. So we'll hold those to the end. And if you do have a question or comment, you're going to need a microphone because we are taping. DSE TV, DSE Enterprises is here, and they are taping this for YouTube and for playback on public television stations so that people not in this room can get the benefit of the conversation. So the first speaker today will be Mr. Martin. He has 30 years of news media, public relations, and marketing experience. He's the recipient of the PR industry's coveted Silver Anvil Award. Do you need to get in? All right, good deal.
And I'm from Kentucky, too.
And you're from Kentucky, too. I did not know that about you. You've received training, right? Right, to speak like that Midwestern tone here. So, well, you're practicing it very well because I would have never guessed. But he's received this Silver Anvil Award and also has received multiple best shows for writing, research, and his campaign planning and execution. I'm sure I think there are many in the audience that are familiar with Roger in that regard. He also taught journalism at his alma mater, Michigan State University, yay, go green, for about a decade. He worked with the Detroit Free Press for a number of years, and during that time received 3 Pulitzer Prize nominations. He now is in the private sector. He specializes in issue management, media relations, crisis communications, and works with a number of trade associations and coalitions about the state and actually across the U.S. So as a partner of the firm and Martin Waymar, he directed the media aspects of the Proposal 1 campaign as well as some coalition management. Following Roger, we'll have Gilda Jacobs. Ms. Jacobs supported Proposal 1 as director for the Michigan League for Public Policy. She became league president and CEO in 2001, following 8 years as Michigan state senator and 4 years as a state house representative. Prior to that, she served as a county commissioner and also served as a city commissioner before that. She had previously worked as a development director for a nonprofit and was a special education teacher, having received her bachelor's degree and a master's degree from the University of Michigan. So she's going to comment on the proposal outcome and options for moving forward. Randall Thompson has served as the executive director of the Coalition Against Higher Taxes and Special Interest Deals, the lead opposition to Proposal 1. He has served as chief of staff in both the U.S. House of Representatives and the Michigan House of Representatives. He served as communications director in the U.S. Congress and to both the Secretary of State and Attorney General of the state of Michigan. He holds a Bachelor of Science from Central Michigan University and a Master of Science in Economics from the University of Detroit Mercy. Mr. Thompson will reflect on the voters' response, the campaign path, and next steps as well. And finally, we have Craig Thiel, who is a senior research associate with Citizens Research Council. He's an observer of Proposal 1. Before joining CRC, Mr. Thiel held positions in both the Senate Fiscal Agency and the House Fiscal Agency. Previously, he worked with the Michigan Department of State, Office of Policy and Planning, and the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency in Chicago. Mr. Thiel holds a BA in Economics and Political Science from Kalamazoo College, go Hornets, and a Master's in Public Administration from Wayne State University. He will be discussing the possible options for Michigan now that the voters have had their say on Proposal 1. So again, we'll hold questions for after Mr. Thiel's presentation, and at this time, we'll open up the discussion. We very much want to hear your comments and your questions. Mr. Martin, if you could please take the microphone, we'll kick this into gear. Thank you.
This is my 12th ballot question campaign, so I've been around this block a number of times. Been on the winning side 8 times, and now on the losing side 4 times. And there are a number of reasons that I will talk about that I think contributed to their victory and certainly the loss of Proposal 1. Then I'm going to talk a little bit about, too, where I think voters are now in the wake of all of this. And I think that'll help sort of set the tone for the rest of the conversation here today, as too. And then any questions you might have, please let us know. Please let us know. I'm happy to answer them. So, first of all, lessons sort of reaffirmed, not lessons learned. Complexity is the kryptonite of yes votes. It is the absolute enemy of yes votes. I'm not going to get into whether this is good policy or bad policy, but let me read 3 good ballot questions to you. What makes a good ballot question? Not necessarily good public policy, but what makes a good ballot question? A good ballot question is marriage is between a man and a woman. Unambiguous, very simple, no, very easy to grasp. You can argue both sides. There's no question about that, but that makes a good ballot question. Good ballot question, no new casinos without a vote of the people. That makes a good ballot question. Makes a good ballot question. Marijuana for medicinal purposes makes a good ballot question. Again, I'm not saying one side or the other is right or wrong. There are arguments on both sides always with a ballot question, but those make good ballot questions. Back on January 23rd, this was 10 days before we were brought on to be part of this campaign, one of our clients whose board was meeting in Lansing and was deciding that day whether to support, oppose, stay neutral on, give money to Proposal 1, asked me to come over and sort of give my prognostications on what I thought was going to happen with Proposal 1 going forward. And I have the memo with me here that I wrote that day, and nothing has changed my mind, actually, going forward from that day. the title of the memo is 6 Reasons Why Proposal 1 Will Fail and 2 Reasons Why It Might Pass. And again, nothing changed my mind. Nothing changed my mind. We worked our tails off to get this thing passed, believe me. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the campaign metrics in just a second, but and I'm not going to go through all 6 reasons, but I'm going to highlight 2 of them. First, if you go back into Michigan history, go back over 30 years, we have never, ever approved a tax increase on ourselves at the ballot. Never happened. Now, people will go, well, what about Proposal A? Totally different animal. Totally different animal. Proposal A, which is the closest sort of benchmark we have to this election, was a sales tax increase or an income tax increase in exchange for a 60% property tax cut. How many of you remember Proposal A? I see a handful of people in the room who definitely remember that. But you know, it was a choice. Back at that time, Michigan's property taxes were so far out of whack compared to the rest of the country. And legislatures and governors for about 22 years, literally 22 years, tried to put some sort of reform to Proposal A on the ballot, to school finance reform and property tax reform on the ballot. And the most recent edition of Bill Ballinger and Susan Demas' Inside Michigan Politics went back and looked at all of those. I want to read this to you because it is so telling. It is so telling. Let's go back to the first Proposal A to reform the state's K-12 school financing system. This is the April 26th edition of Inside Michigan Politics, just a week or so ago. I'm not talking about the second Proposal A, the famous A that was approved on March 15, 1994. I'm talking about the A that voters defeated just 9 months earlier on June 2nd, 1993. The first A, blah, 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 blah. Lost by a relatively close margin of 7 points, 53 to 46, okay? That almost seemed like a win compared with the previous 11 attempts to shift school funding away from property taxes during the preceding 21 years, which voters had turned down. 11 different times legislatures and governors went to the ballot to try to reform that, and every one of them failed. Every one of them failed. They were complex, voters didn't get them. There were a lot of reasons why. And Rick Reiner probably might remember some of those over the years, and we go back that far. I see Rick back there, but it's just very difficult. It's very difficult. Yeah. It's just very difficult. It's just very difficult to get voters. So that was one reason. The second reason, or the sixth reason that on my memo was, the legislature made this proposal quite complex. It's not just a simple one penny more for roads proposal. They add a number of other provisions that many can argue amount to good public policy, but that make the proposal far more complex and complicated to explain. Complexity is the enemy of yes votes for ballot questions. Complexity also blocks voter comprehension, understanding, reinforcing the distrust and suspicion voters increasingly have for Lansing and Washington. Nothing changed over the last 12 weeks. Nothing changed over the last 12 weeks. So, you know, complexity is the enemy of yes votes. That's sort of lesson one, number one. Here's lesson number two. Some of you are probably legislative staffers. I see some lawmakers in here. I see Representative Shore and some others. For goodness sakes, before you put something on the ballot, research it. Folks, research it. Determine if there's even a snowball's chance in heck of voters approving it. Don't cobble something together in the waning hours of a legislative session and say, we got the votes. Now let's go try to figure out if we can pass it. That's not the way normally you go through a ballot question. I see Scott Harris, there's a number of us in the room who have gone through ballot proposal fights in the past, Bill. Normally you start the process like this. You have a client or you have an organization or someone out there who has a public policy challenge. And then that individual or organization's lawyers and policy people get together and they say, okay, here's one solution, here's two solutions, here's seven solutions. This would get the job done. Then they hire researchers to go out and do focus groups, all kinds of voter surveys, and then once that research is done, you go back to the client and you say, you don't have a chance on these four, or you have a chance on this one. This one's a slam dunk could pass, or stands a really good chance of passing. The absolute wrong way of doing a ballot question is putting it together, throwing it on the ballot, and then trying to decide if it can pass. It's suicidal. The chances of it winning, it's like shooting an arrow without aiming, It's just very, very difficult to do. The other thing I didn't anticipate on the six item list, I did not anticipate the level of hostility and anger there is out there. It is palpable, folks. And Randall, I know you felt it. I know I felt it. I did 23 different speaking events myself as part of over the last 12 weeks. And our Speakers Bureau and our coalition did 191 speaking events in 12 weeks. Our coalition members then combined did a little bit more than 500 more. We had people everywhere. The governor, the lieutenant governor, and a word about the governor. I have not worked closely with him on many issues. I worked real closely with him over the last 12 weeks. My respect for him has increased dramatically. Dislike the proposal, like the proposal. This guy worked his tail off. Never moved away for a second. He knew the numbers were not good. He never gave up the ship, said we're going to keep working hard, we're going to keep working hard till election day, because that's the solution that we were confronted with. That's what we were trying to pass. So to that, he deserves a real strong attaboy, a real strong attaboy. But, you'd walk into a room and you could feel the daggers coming out. And it started with, why didn't they do it? Why are we voting on this? In May of 2015, we've never done this before. And then you had to explain a constitutional amendment with 10 bills attached to it. Once you at the point of trying to explain something like that to voters, you've lost them. There's not a chance. So Going forward, what next? There's a new poll out today for those of you who have to now confront this problem. Again, it's Epic MRA poll. And these questions were put on this poll. This is the same Epic MRA poll that came out last week that showed voters' opposition to Proposal 1 at 61-29, right? So the same voters who said, we hate Proposal 1. We hate Proposal 1. Here's what the poll found. 87% of Michigan voters want the legislature to, these voters want the legislature to go back to work immediately and fix the roads. 87%. Folks, in polling, that's almost unanimity. It's very hard to get much above that in a poll. 64%, this is interesting. We asked them to test a couple of potential revenue increases, just assuming that they may or may not be part of a solution here. Bernie Porn had tested a one penny increase in the sales tax guaranteed to roads, period, nothing more. That simple, nothing more complicated. So many times in past surveys, he never saw support better than 53-54%. It's now at 64. It's never been there. Never been in the 60s before. So what Proposal 1, in his opinion, did was it focused voters on, well, sure as heck what they don't want, but what they're willing to live with, too. So I think that's very telling as you are going forward trying to fix this mess. Let me see what else. Oh, in terms of cuts, I know there's been cuts-only proposals out there. 88% opposed major cuts. We didn't describe what major cuts were. We just said major cuts, assuming that you had to raise $1.2 to $1.3 billion a year. We didn't describe what major cuts would be, because who knows. 88% would oppose major cuts to K-12 education to pay for roads. 74% strongly. That is an intensity level that should make any legislator pause. That is an incredibly high intensity level. 86% oppose major cuts to health care and Medicaid. 74% strongly. Again, an intensity level that is very significant. 63% oppose major cuts to universities, community colleges. 76% oppose major cuts in revenue sharing. Those are very strong numbers. So, you know, as you're going forward, it appears that voters know what they don't want. And what they do want is they want the legislature to go back and fix the roads and do it in a way that raises revenues without eviscerating every essential service that is important to Michigan and makes this a livable place. So with that, I'd be happy to turn it over to Gilda. Are you next?
Just by the very fact that so many of you are here today, I think this is one of the biggest luncheons that IBSRS has had, shows how much interest there still is in this, as some people are calling it, the autopsy report. And then how do we, how do we move forward and kind of resurrect the body? And I think that for the League, and for those of you who don't know much about the Michigan League for Public Policy, we're an organization that is a research and policy organization that works on behalf of low-income people in the state. We've been doing this for 103 years, so we've seen the roads go actually from the horse and buggy days to, well, not quite, to people zooming down the roads. And what I want to do is kind of talk about why the League got involved in this in the first place, because from the outset, there were many people from kind of the progressive folks that support us and saying, well, by increasing the sales tax, you are increasing the regressivity of the taxes, which has a more negative impact on low-income people. But the great thing that was cobbled together in the throes of the evening was the full restoration of the earned income tax credit, which was a huge agenda item for the League. It's been on our agenda since it was cut from 20% to 6% of the federal EITC. So that was really an important thing for us as part of the compromise that was crafted for this proposal. In addition, there was money put in for public transportation. Low-income people don't have cars often and rely on the bus system. And that bus system had not gotten a shot in the arm for a couple of decades. And again, there was money for this, in addition to making up for the hole that was going to be blown in the school aid fund with removing the sales tax from gas. So there were some really, really important policy wins, if you will, for the people that the League advocates for. So now, moving forward, the concern that the League has and our partners have moving forward is that any plan that gets put together, gets crafted, can't have a negative effect on the people that we care about. Oftentimes, we see when the resources dry up or get tight, we see money taken out of human services or healthcare or schools and things that are shifted around. We don't want any more budgets to be balanced on the backs of those that can least afford it. So those are the concerns that we will come to the conversation and to the discussion with. And either the legislature has to decide that we're going to grow the pot, or they, if they're going to want to not increase taxes, and you know, I know a lot of people run for office and they run on a increase tax platform. Where are you going to squeeze the money out to provide some of the essential services that we need in order to have what we feel is a good quality of life in our state? So we're going to be very concerned about the potential negative impact on those that have the least. Now, I'm a former legislator. I understand that when everybody comes to figure out how you're going to be voting for something like this, you're going to still need to compromise. There are a lot of folks in the Republican caucus that are just not going to vote for any kind of a tax increase, which means that there's going to need to be conversations with the Democratic caucuses, and they're going to want certain things that are going to be in whatever gets crafted. So people are still going to come together. Deals, if you will, are still going to need to be made around this. And I think we just have to recognize that that's kind of a fact of life in terms of how Lansing operates. I just want to go to the Proposal A conversation for just a second. So I remember Proposal A so well. And even though my personal property taxes at home were cut by 50%, which is what the proponents were all arguing for, and I am still in that home, so it has still been wonderful for me. It's been great. Proposal A was meant to help seniors who couldn't afford to stay in their homes. Well, most of those seniors have died, but their grandchildren are looking to buy homes now. And they, because the cap comes off when a home is sold, young families can't afford to purchase homes anymore. So, lesson learned is be careful of unintended consequences, or sometimes intended consequences. I wasn't in the legislature when Proposal A was passed, but maybe they figured everybody would have a very short memory and, you know, kind of not remember the whole process. But I think we have to be very careful as we move forward on this to really look at what the effect of whatever we do is going to be having long-term in terms of an economic impact. You talked about the polling, which I think is really, really important, because I think people in the state really are wise, but we really need to be able to kind of bring folks together and move forward, and I think we just have to let all of this go and really all partner with each other moving forward.
My name is Randall Thompson. I serve as the executive director for the Coalition Against Higher Taxes and Special Interest Deals. I want to begin my comments today, I guess, with just kind of a look back. People often forget that it was January 29th. They had run a poll between the 27th and 29th, I think, of January, where Proposal 1 was actually ahead, 46% to 41%. And people, you know, it was a very small sampling, but nevertheless, there was still not a great understanding of what Proposal 1 entailed. They just knew it was a roads package. It was going to fix the roads. And I think over that next 5 weeks or so, with the changeover in leadership, and that's why I said, you know, we were just talking, Roger and I were talking before the program began, and I said, you know, it's so hard because when you have a bad piece of public policy from a consumer standpoint or from a voter standpoint, they look at it is you're almost doomed to begin with. You know, it was hard for us who've worked in politics for a long time, because regardless of what side you're on, you feel for people. You know, when you see them having to go into some of those attendees or some of those events where they're getting hammered on questions and the vitriol and so on. There was that 5-week period of time where there was the change in leadership and everything, and you know, it took some time to get online, and the first ads came out, I think, on March 6th. And so it was during that 5-week period of time where we formed the ballot committee on January 30th, and Paul Mitchell, our chairman, we weren't going to do consultants, we weren't going to do strategists, we weren't going to do anything like that. We were going to use our gut, and we were going to talk to a lot of people. And so I'll talk a little bit about the tactics that we used. But we had put out press release after press release after press release for 5 weeks, and just hammered home all these different talking points, talking about the intricacies of the proposal. Rather than taking a slant on it or anything like that, he wanted to throw as much data, as much information out there as possible over that period of time. And what you saw was it flipped from 46 to 41, that we knew that it was going to be a Herculean effort, you know, David versus Goliath, if you will. But voters wanted information. They just wanted to be told what is this all about. When you do have a constitutional amendment that's going to be, enacted forever. You know, they want to make sure that it's the right thing to do. We were talking a little bit about the coalition. Gilda brought up about, you know, the left and the right. And so often we think of that as a linear line, you know, where it's the far right and the far left. And what we found actually with our coalition was it actually became a circle. Is, you know, you'd have the far right and the far left, but everybody was kind of joined together. We had union members and progressives. I'm a Republican, I have been all my life. And so you'd get media requests in, and there was a couple progressive radio shows that asked for us to come on. And, you know, when it's ingrained in your mind, you almost are hesitant because, well, we're going to get hammered here. And, I mean, it was, I agree with you. I kind of gave two answers and then said, you go, I'll shut up, you talk, because that was the way it went. The radio hosts and the callers, the anger and the intensity and the passion was palpable, to say the least. The tactics used that we had on this, and I think this is important from a public policy standpoint too, was when voters want information, it's not about TV commercials or anything. Paul, actually, another great idea that he had, said from the outset, we're going to focus on social media and teletown halls. We're going to do as much interaction as possible, and we're going to respond to every single question that comes in. We're going to throw our website out there. Yeah, it's going to be hard and long hours, and there's going to be a whole lot. We get sometimes 50 to 70 emails a day just on questions. These teletown halls, for those of you that have implemented them before, you'll do an outbound dialer. We were doing 30 to 50,000 households a week, starting back at the beginning of February. And usually you'll have a 2 or 3 minute duration where they'll stay on the phone for 2 or 3 minutes, they'll get what they need, and they'll hang up. That's been at least my experience with it. And people almost thought we were lying. People were staying on for 12 to 14 minutes. We had one call where the people were on 16 minutes as an average. So that means out of 25,000 households that were on that call, you had 12,000 that were staying on longer than that. And, you know, I mean, that's the mean, the medium. 12 to 16 minutes. I mean, that's just unheard of. And they'd hang on and they'd ask questions. And we took all the tough ones. And I think that's what made people think it was authentic, because it wasn't where we were just taking the softballs. You know, move this person up front, move this person up front. He's like, no, take the ones that are most angry or that are most passionate about yes and put them through. Let's have that dialogue. And that dialogue created a sense of understanding. We did 9 weeks of teletown halls with 30 to 50,000 each week, and then we did a super call, or big call, whatever you want to call it, 150,000 households right before absentee. And then we did another 150,000 on Monday night. And the response was just, it was far, far surpassed anything that we could have imagined. 36,000 people on Facebook, you know, messages galore. But it was the fact that we answered, and it was the fact that it was that explanation, specific explanation, not just a, you know, here's a generic answer, thank you for your email, that kind of thing, or thank you for your question. We also focused on get out the vote effort. I mean, as much when it's, there's such a disparity in spending, all we could do was try and get our folks out to the polls, and that was the main, hurdle, I guess, for the last few weeks. Was we were very concerned because there was estimates of a million that were going to vote, 1.2. Mark Grebner had said 1.5 maybe. And, you know, we kept saying the more people we get out, the better we'll do. Paul had called this a marriage of kind of bad policy and bad politics, and Roger hit it right on the head, is that when you pass something at 5:30 in the morning on the last day of lame duck session, and you, the argument that you're going to use is we need to fix the roads, then it kind of gives the opposition, the no side, all the ammunition necessary for us to say, wait a second, but $800 million is going to debt and only $400 million is going to the roads the first year, and you say this is a roads package. If our lives are truly in jeopardy, then you take everything you have and you throw it at the problem. You don't add $700 million onto other things. Voters want transparency. You know, I have a master's in economics, and this was a lesson for me as well, was this was not about numbers. This truly was about policy, and that's what I think just made it so incredibly hard to be able to sell to the public, was the main reasons against it were not only the complexity. I mean, if there's one, you know, I think different perspective that we might have, I think voters did get it, and they didn't like it. You know, I don't think that it was about it, that it was complex or that they didn't understand it. I saw a lot of news stories where they were saying, you know, it was because of the fact that people didn't understand it. I think they did understand it, and I think they just really rejected it. They want three things out of government, and we heard time and time again on all of these calls, on all the social media interaction, all the emails and everything else, was if you're going to do something, first take care of your own house. First, take care of your own budget. Make sure that you're being as fiscally responsible as you possibly can and show an effort to reduce costs, reduce spending. And don't make it the false narrative or the false choice, because I felt bad for some of the legislators that were out there, because the main thing that they would say was it was a choice between education and police and fire. They'd get hammered because they'd say, no, that's a false choice. If we as taxpayers have problems in our household, and we have more bills than we have revenue, you don't say first we're not going to pay the mortgage. You don't say first we're not going to eat. You say we're going to reduce our cable channels. We're going to, you know, cut down on going out to eat and all that kind of stuff. So it's essential services. I think that's the reason that you see the polling that you see. Nobody wants to cut education. Nobody on the no side wants to cut education. Nobody on the no side doesn't think our roads are bad. You know, we want to fix the roads too. But you've got to show that effort of reduce spending first, prioritize what you have, so you can't, you know, say that it's roads versus, you know, some of the film credits or, you know, I mean, when voters hear this, they look at it and is, well, is that a luxury or is that a necessity? Is that a luxury or is that a necessity? Roads are first, so you got to do that. And then after that, you can talk about everything else. So first you reduce spending, then you reprioritize. And then third, if and only if you go through those first two steps, then you can come back to taxpayers and say, we've done all we can truly, and we need more money, and here's the way we're going to have to do it. Then, I mean, from all the different speaking engagements that you know, the yes and the no side had, you saw heads nod all over the state. All over the state, didn't matter socioeconomic background, it didn't matter whether they were left or right, Republican, Democrat, liberal, conservative, heads started nod, yeah, okay, that makes sense. And I think that was the thing that I wanted to impress upon you today, is from a public policy standpoint, is not only does it need to be clean, but it needs to be, you know, one, two, three. Those three steps need to be satisfied before you'll get that unanimity in terms of nodding heads. And then finally, the one thing that Proposal 1 did do is it changed the dynamic of what's going to happen going forward, where you do have a lot of legislators that have signed no tax pledges. But what I think the dynamic has changed in terms of legislators, public policy, you know, bill people that draft bills and so on, if you're going to try and put legislation together, we kind of give you an out almost. They're going to say, well, at least it ain't that, you know, is we're going to go through the next several months and you know, hopefully work starts today on that. I can't necessarily speak for Paul, but certainly in my own estimation is you have to find ways to reduce spending. Then you have to reprioritize. And then if after all those things are done, you come back and you say, well, we need a gas tax or we need this or we need that, then I think you'll get a much more favorable response from taxpayers. So I thank you for your time and I'll be happy to take any questions when we're done.
Make an observation. If these were the warring sides in the last 6 weeks, we were Switzerland. The Citizens Research Council didn't have a horse in this race or a dog in this fight. We were out there. We made, between myself and my colleagues at the Research Council, close to 30 presentations across the state, Traverse City, Grand Rapids, Jackson, Detroit area, and Lansing. So we've been following this fairly closely as well. And have to echo some of the same comments that the presenters mentioned about some of the voter reactions. That's not our specialty. We're researchers, but clearly a sense of our word was distrust in government that came across. So, well, we know nothing's changed, at least in terms of the condition of the roads in the last 24 hours. Roads across the state are going to remain in abysmal condition and only get worse until something's done to address them, specifically not until more is invested. The big question for today, with all due respect to the previous speakers, is what's next? How does Michigan reverse its neglect of transportation infrastructure? How does the state and local governments obtain the funds to boost investment? I was invited to speak about some of the alternative possibilities as the debate shifts from the ballot box back to the legislative arena. We're likely to see, as the legislature turns its attention yet again to this vexing problem, how do we fix the roads? So looking forward, generally speaking, the state responses fall into three broad categories. First, the state can continue to cobble together resources, primarily from the general fund, to address some of the investment needs. We've been doing this for the last few years, basically tapping into the state general fund to make sure that we don't leave federal dollars on the table. This is likely only a near-term solution, and it's not likely to provide the long-term solution if we're talking about $1.2 billion in annual additional investment. Does anyone know about an additional $1.2 billion laying around on the Senate or House appropriations floors? I don't think so. In terms of long-term solutions, likely alternatives fall into two camps. One approach is to reprioritize the existing spending that the state is doing. That is, increase transportation funding and reducing spending somewhere else in the budget. In light of the results from yesterday, many observers are going to make that case. That's exactly what voters said. But keep in mind a few fiscal facts about the state budget and about the amount of wiggle room that state lawmakers have in constructing this $52 billion state budget. And these are some figures I picked up from Senate Fiscal, reliable source. 42% of the state budget, federal funding, including the transportation funds that we're already investing in roads and bridges, as well as a big chunk for healthcare, Medicaid. 38% is restricted funding, with the largest amount going into the school aid fund for K through 12 education. Only 19% of the state budget is general fund spending. Oh, that's where we'll find the solution. But hold on. Of the $52 billion that the state spends annually, the Senate Fiscal Agency estimates that approximately 8% is only truly discretionary. That's the amount that legislatures on an annual basis have to move things around. So this is after you take off the federal dollars, the state dollars needed to match the federal dollars, the state restricted dollars that are going to schools already or local governments. So 8%, about $4.3 billion. So another approach, this one reflected in Proposal 1, is to increase state spending by raising taxes to generate the additional revenue. Fuel taxes, registration taxes, sales taxes, income taxes, pot taxes. Really, anything's on the table at this point. In considering the various alternatives, however, the legislature is going to have to consider these three big areas. The scale of the investment increase. Again, we've talked about billions. We're talking about three positions to the left of the decimal. I'm talking about billions of dollars, nine zeros following the decimal, okay? Not millions of dollars. The timing of the transportation funding increase as well. Is it going to be an all at once or a phased in approach? This most recent approach was phased in over 3 years. Previous approaches had phased in approaches as well. Finally, the political realities, 56, 20, and 1. Obviously, these are the votes that are needed to get through the House, the Senate, and signed by the governor. So in terms of alternative solutions, the likely place that the legislature is going to start is with the recent plans that have passed. Not because these represent some type of silver bullet, but because these are the plans that met that third condition, political approval. Example of both approaches, the House plan that was passed in December involved finding the solution from within the existing state budget. That involved a phase in of the fuel tax increase, basically shifting from a flat excise tax to a tax on the wholesale price of gas, with a simultaneous reduction in the 6% sales tax, so motorists wouldn't notice a difference in price at the pump. The Senate plan, however, which was passed in November, maintained the sales tax on fuel and increased the motor fuel tax, also shifting the nature of the tax from a straight per gallon excise tax to a wholesale tax based on the price of fuel. Both plans generated significant revenues for roads. They differed in three areas. One, the amount of revenue that was brought into the state. Two, how quickly the new funds would be raised. And three, who effectively pays for the increased investment in the road system. This chart highlights the differences between the two plans in terms of the amount of revenue and the timing. The Senate plan raised more money more quickly than the House plan. By the third year, 2018, the identified need of $1.2 billion would have been raised under the Senate plan. The House plan, however, because of the more gradual phase-in approach, did not generate this amount of revenue until 2021. How quickly would alternative plans that come forward from the legislature generate the $1.2 billion that's been identified? Proposal one would have done it within a three-year time frame. The biggest and most significant difference between the two plans, really between the two different approaches that are out there, is related to the question of who pays. The Senate plan had the users of the transportation system, motorists, pay for the increased investment in terms of higher gas prices. This plan raised taxes, fuel taxes, without an offsetting reduction in other taxes that consumers pay. Under this plan, we estimate that motorists' tax burden would have been between $100 and $300 in additional taxes paid each year. The House plan, however, shifted the burden of its fuel tax increase from motorists to other areas of the budget. And this is where we talk about cuts to education and local government. And this is reflected here in the chart I've got before you. By reprioritizing state spending, the House plan reduced state funds to schools and local governments and increased state spending for roads. Because of the phase out of the sales tax on motor fuels, schools and local governments saw a reduction in their earmarked revenues. The hit to schools is gradual, but eventually increases to $800 million when the sales tax was fully phased out on motor fuel. That's 2021. So what if the legislature fails to act on in any one of these two areas? Well, I don't know if another ballot proposal is in the works, if the citizenry is going to petition the legislature to put something on the ballot. There's a number of lessons, obviously, to be learned from Proposal 1. You know, how would it be structured? We talked a little bit about Proposal A of 1994. I think a key distinction there was in every other previous attempt to change the school finance system was that the status quo was available. People could just say, yeah, I hate the property tax system, but the status quo isn't that bad. So they could go back. And clearly that was an option here, recognizing the fact that there was a sizable tax increase too. But in the previous attempts of school finance, the status quo was there. It was only when the status quo wasn't available that people actually chose a different taxing scheme. What else would a ballot proposal contain? Would it only address the transportation needs? What taxes? Would the sales tax be involved, an income tax, some other type of tax? And finally, we heard, when we were out making presentations, concerns about reforms to Public Act 51. A very complicated act, to be sure, but clearly this goes into Randall's comments that people were concerned about the efficiency of the current spending, and that is really couched in Public Act 51 and the allocation of the resources. It's also important to point out that the state's failure to act has prompted local governments to take this on, that is, take on increased road funding. Local officials have constituents too, and they're responsive to those constituents. We've seen increased local attention to roads in terms of dedicated millages, bonding proposals. Some of them got wrapped up in the no fervor of yesterday's vote, I noticed. Clearly, as the state drags its feet in this regard, I think we'll see more and more local governments responding to constituent needs for infrastructure investment. It's important to point out that the options available to locals is very constrained. They can bond, they have to get voter approval, they can dedicate some property taxes subject to limitations, but they don't have the option of local sales tax, gasoline taxes, and registration taxes. Only cities are able to do the local income tax. And if the state is going to continue to drag its feet and expect local governments to pick up some of the slack here, they may need authorization to access some of these revenue enhancements.
We heard about a few options, all of which included a need for more money some way, somehow, and would have to be sold more or less, or I guess would have to be more convincing to the general public for people to take that measure. We've been down this road before, but there's never been a case study such as this. It has so many oddities, not only in the campaign, the proposal building process, the campaign, but just the very request and how it was put out there. Our director of the Institute for Public Policy and Social Research, Doug Roberts, who is to my left here, has been through this process. And as Roger mentioned Proposal A, a couple of people had mentioned Proposal A in that process. Not an easy one. It had gone through several different versions before someone hiccuped and it actually was passed. So, and we still, I'm sure Doug, I've heard many people still talk with you about how they were for it or against it, or how they are for it or against it this many years past. So I think we're gonna open it up to you and get your questions and comments.
Being from Ingham County, over 30% of us can deal with complexity, apparently, because we voted yes. Ingham, Washington, and Gojibik, and I don't have an explanation for that. Maybe you do. But is there a way with changes to the statute, Public Act 51, that we could start out with a proposal that would be legislature only, no voter involvement, revenue neutral to start with, but that would contain growth, keeping in mind we're using less gasoline, we're using more electricity for our cars and our transportation system, that starts out neutral, revenue neutral, no tax increase, but a change in the flat amount of money that we give to gasoline right now, which, you know, per gallon is kind of crazy. It's kind of a way to do this that would allow revenue growth. Is there a way to get there? Because I, from what I was hearing from my people, they don't mind fixing, they want the roads fixed, they don't mind paying a little bit more, but they want to do it gradually, they don't want it to be complicated, and they want the legislature itself to do it. So is there a way to do it with Public Act 51 changes alone, maybe?
Is this working now?
Yeah. Okay, good. So Public Act 51 deals with the distribution of the revenue.
Right.
It's the motor fuel tax and the other tax acts that deal with the generation of the revenue. So the question is, you know, how do you get at the fact that with the gasoline tax or a motor fuel tax, we have a fixed rate and a declining base? Well, you can change the rate so it adjusts, recognizing that the base is declining. And that's exactly what the Senate proposal basically did. It gradually phased in a wholesale price based motor fuel tax. That's one way to solve that problem. You know, the sales tax, the income tax, they all have a fixed rate, but a rising base, and that's why it generates additional revenue, absent economic disruptions, of course. But that would be the solution. Public Act 51, the distribution of the revenue, that's been a debate that's been had, and an ongoing debate in the legislature since 97. It was explicitly taken off the table in the discussions here. It's a question whether or not it becomes part of the debate going forward.
I did about 20 presentations on Proposal 1. A couple observations. Number one, even though we had 80% of the voters vote no on Proposal 1, we had about half of the millage proposals on the ballots at the same time actually passed. And I don't know too many of them that really went down in flames. So it was obvious that it wasn't just a straight, you know, no new tax issue. It was, I'm going to pick and choose what I'm going to do. Second, it's interesting to hear about the Epic MRA poll, because SEMCOG, along with the Metropolitan Affairs Coalition, put out a non-scientific poll out on the internet. And we did somewhat the same thing, that we asked, okay, are you going to vote for or against Proposal 1? We got the same kind of results, you know, 62% going to vote no. And then we followed up for the people who voted no. We said, well, what would you do? And it was interesting. We gave them a list of like five options. Top option, 60% said, raise the gas tax. You know, 35% said, well, raise the registration fees. 20% don't do anything. By the way, they can choose multiple options. 26% said, okay, cut all the justice stuff, the corrections budget, court budget, state police budget, and universities. And then 10%, the lowest option, was take the money out of schools and local government. So it's interesting that we were running a non-scientific poll coming up with almost exactly the same kind of results that Epic MRA was coming up with.
I am glad that the ballot went down. And the reason is that why should the citizens vote a tax against itself? I think the legislators should do the voting for the taxes. And the legislature should do its work instead of passing it on to the citizens to decide. Also, I think a state has to decide what kinds of environment it wants to have for its citizens. And then, do we want the prisons to be mental health institutions? Do we want better roads? What do we want? And somebody should have a vision as to what the state ought to be like, and not dump it in the lap of the citizens to try to figure it out. That's why you guys are voted in.
First of all, if the legislature wants to solve the problem, they need to lock the doors and keep the lobbyists out. And they need to start being voter and citizen centric instead of lobbyists and special interest centric. That's number one. Then the second, they have to change the mindset in terms of other people's money. We're always trying to shift money from one person to another person. Users of government services are the ones that should pay for those services. Drivers are willing to pay for the roads. They're not willing to pay a sales tax on the fuel tax to pay for buses or pay for higher education. That's a bunch of baloney. And you also have to, and a caveat to that is, drivers are now getting hit with very high automobile insurance rates. And those rates were created by the special interest in the healthcare lobby. You know, the the medical provider bills for an accident, medical care for an accident victim to the PIP, and the PIP gives a blank check to the medical provider and says, here, you fill any amount of money. So an MRI for you or me would cost $500. For an automobile accident victim, it's $2,000, and that just jacks up the insurance rates. Somebody mentioned something about there's no place to cut. There's so much bloat in higher education and public education that can be whacked. Eastern Michigan University, why do we even need that thing? Close it down. The University of Michigan Health Care System, why is that a nonprofit? That should be a profit organization that should be paying tax to the state of Michigan. U of M would do very fine as a private institution that doesn't need taxpayers' support. On the micro level, you read in the Lansing Journal that the Lansing superintendent gets $800 a month, $9,600 a year car allowance. Why the hell are we paying for that? I don't want to pay for her car. I should pay my own car. You read these things about the MEA people getting $140,000 a year pensions. They're working for the MEA and they're funneling money through the school districts, the Kalamazoo School District, the Lansing School District. What the hell are we paying that for? I don't want to pay for that. You read about school teachers making $100,000+ a year for 9 months' work. That's ridiculous. How many people that are working at Walmart or whatever? I think a lot of these folks that are feeding at the public job, are going to get jobs at Walmart for a year and find out what it's really like to make money in this economy. We need to rely on the private sector, shift money from the public sector, and a lot of these problems can be solved in the private market rather than through the state government.
I think that there were a lot of great comments from the panel, and I appreciate that. And as a person who was trying to explain this to my residents, it was a lot of working pieces, and I think that, as we know, that's what the problem was. However, one of the things that I know I'm worried about as a elected leader is there the political will in Lansing to get something passed and get something done? We had Randall talk about, you know, our budget as needs and wants. And we had the explanation of people felt that our needs are public safety, our police, fire, local revenue sharing, education. But as I think we've heard from some people in this audience, what people consider their mortgage payment and their cable payment differs.
Yes.
Is there going to be the political will, do you think, to get something passed that doesn't cut what it seems that the majority of Michigan residents consider to be a mortgage payment, not a cable payment?
Gilda?
So I'm very concerned about the political will. The legislature generally breaks for the summer. I think this would be kind of political suicide for them to do that this year. I think that they need to really figure out a way to come together to make this work. I really appreciated Craig's dissection, if you will, of what our budget looks like. And to see that this $52 billion budget figure that's thrown out all the time is really incorrect, and that when you really look at discretionary spending, it's only $4.3 billion, only, but we're a huge state. We're one of the biggest states in the union. So we don't have really a lot of excess money, discretionary money, to be shifting around, and I think that's part of the education process that elected officials need to have with their constituents, because they need to really understand what the kind of fiscal challenges they're dealing with. The revenue estimating conference is coming up Friday. I'm not sure what that's going to show. I believe revenues are down. And again, it's taking less resources to do what we need to do to have some decent quality of life in our state. What's really interesting to me is there are certain times when the legislature, the current legislature, chooses not to accept federal funds for things like food assistance, or the governor wisely put money in for child care facility inspectors that we need to upgrade that, for example. There was a federal audit that showed the state was doing a terrible job and the kids were really at risk. And there are people who are making decisions right now that say we don't want to accept those federal dollars because we want to be good stewards of all dollars, whether they're federal dollars or state dollars, when, you know, here's a way that doesn't even cost us anything and we can help kids in our state. So when you go back to political will, it really makes me worried. It really does. And I think that legislators have to really kind of examine why they've been sent to Lansing, and that they really have to do a job and make very tough decisions, and sometimes actually work over the summer as well.
Two things. One, I do believe there's the political will. I absolutely believe it. There's 30% is the new legislature. Of the new legislature's brand new. You got a new Speaker of the House, new Senate Majority Leader. As much as we've heard, you know, the term there's no plan B from a lot of elected officials, the first story out last night in the Free Press was about the 10 different plans that are going to be proposed today, right after the polls closed. I mean, it was within an hour of when the polls closed. They're going to have to coalesce around something. These ladies and gentlemen that are in the legislature now campaigned on this last fall. People forget about that. This was still an issue last fall before the election. So when they were knocking on people's doors, people said, what are you going to do about roads? How are you going to fix the roads? What are you going to do about it? And I think that played in a little bit was, you know, Roger and I were just talking about that, where people understood that it was a constitutional amendment and it had to be, you know, put back to the public. They didn't like it. I mean, because of that, it was almost felt like a punt, even when it was constitutionally required, you know, for a vote. But I mean, I think the biggest takeaway that I have, and I want to impress upon it once again and be, I guess, a little bit more blunt if I have to, is that if anyone's takeaway from this proposal is that voters didn't get it or it was too complicated, I would take great umbrage with that, because they did. And I mean, we heard it on those teletown halls and from all the different speaking engagements and everything. It wasn't that people didn't understand. They read the proposal, they read the bills. A lot of people had done their homework, and once they learned about what was in it, they really disagreed with it. And to my point is, when you have Wayne County at 81% no, and Kent County at 73% no, and Oakland County at 77% no, and Genesee County at 83% no, here's left and right, the you know, ends of the spectrum from Republicans and Democrats that spoke resound. I mean, this once in a generation type vote here. And so I think we need to respect that and say, okay, is the legislators not going to pay attention to that? You know, President Reagan always said, you find something that 80% of the people agree with you and stand next to it and smile. Well, they've got their work cut out for them now, and they know that they're going to have to be held accountable for this. Even folks like Senator Mike Shirky, who was a proponent of Proposal 1, said it's our responsibility if this goes down. So I think there is the political will, and I think they'll get it done.
One message that was clear from last night, it is that the voters, us, want them to fix it. They don't want voters to fix it, they want them, whether it's cuts, whether it's revenues, whether it's combinations thereof, it's their job. Get back to work, fix the frickin' roads. That was the one clear message we heard from everything. And I, you know, to Randall's point, I was on Monday night, my last debate in all of this was Monday night at the Anchor Bar in Detroit. It's the first time I've ever seen a bar night for a ballot proposal in my entire experience running ballot questions. And it was put on by WDET Radio and the Free Press. And Leon Drillet, a former very conservative, consistently conservative small government Republican from Macomb County, was my foil. And Steve Henderson was the moderator, and then Eric Lufer from the Citizens Research Council was there, is sort of providing the perspective of sort of trying to keep us tame, I think. But this was a room, because downtown Detroit, filled with progressive Democrats, there's no question about it. The opposition to Proposal 1 in that room was running at 90%. It was running at 90%. And I, to the one point, it's how you describe complexity here. Voters, it was too complex for voters. They want a simple solution. They don't want an earned income tax credit and a gas tax increase and a sales tax increase and a registration fee increase and a hybrid tax and everything else that was rolled into Proposal 1 as part of the solution. They just want the roads fixed. Give me something simple that I can comprehend where the money goes to roads, guaranteed period, I'll pay more. I assure you, legislators, if you're going back to work, that will pass. Voters will not hold you accountable for it. It will pass. It will pass.
Somewhat frightening is that we only have a year and a half with these people who know this proposal pretty darn well and who have been out there talking with their constituents about that. Because actually we have a little less than a year and a half, because they're going to be out on the campaign trail again and we're going to have another election. So we may have new people in leadership positions that do not know that you only have 8% of the general budget, general fund budget. So, scary thought. The microphone is...
I have one here.
Thank you.
I'm just here as a citizen also, like this gentleman over here. And listening, I guess a few comments. Number one, I agree that the legislature needs to get off their behinds and do something about this. With regard to the comments that were made by the gentleman next to me, I'm actually paid by the Veterinary College at MSU, and I don't know the statistics for this year, but that college gets about 11% of their budget from the state now. So there isn't that much more to bleed out. And when you bleed it out, guess what's going to happen? We're going to have a lot more out-of-state students and students from China or other countries that can pay more tuition coming into our state university. So is that really what you want? Thirdly, about the $100,000 a year we pay to teachers, I'm not sure whether that's right or not at the K through 12 level, but I wouldn't want my kids being taught by the greeters of Kmart. So, you know, you got to pay for what you want. I'm here really because a little over a year ago, when the first thaw came, I was driving up Hagedorn Road with some recruits to our graduate program. And bam, bam, I hit a pothole. It was a rainy night. I couldn't see it. I was only going about 35 miles an hour. I managed to limp into the I-Building parking lot over there. It cost $1,500 to get that one fixed. But in the parking lot, there were many, many other cars that had hit that very same one pothole, including a couple of students who I went over and talked to. And the poor guy was just about in tears. He said, you know, I don't know how I'm going to get the money to get this fixed. And this really gets to, I think, some of the things that Ms. Jacobs was saying. I think we need, and I'll say this, I'm an independent voter, but I tend to be a bleeding heart liberal myself, but I think we need to get the bleeding heart liberals out of this and have a one-issue campaign. You know, those poor guys that probably would rather pay $100 more a year in taxes than what it was going to cost to get that car fixed.
One of the takeaways that we have from this election is that the people are telling the legislature, do your job, you know, if there's going to be a tax increase, do the vote. But I find it a bit ironic that we have a constitution that says if we're going to increase any tax at the local level, it must go to the citizens. So why is it that we have this viewpoint that a tax increase at the state level should never go to the citizens, but a tax increase at the local level should only go to the citizens? Anyone want to come up with that answer?
Well, I'll comment because the CRC talked about this, and we've put out an essay on the topic. And Rogers' takeaway from the election is the legislature to do your job, just fix this. Well, we, the citizenry, have made it darn near impossible for them to take on massive financial problems of the state, like road funding. We have populated the Constitution with earmarking provisions that tie the hands of the legislature. We've populated the Constitution with tax limitations that tie the hands of the legislature. Now, in an ideal situation, we would vote for the amount of resources that are necessary to hit all the priorities. The legislature would allocate it according to our priorities, and they'd be done with it. But our forebears have decided that they want to tie the hands of the legislature out of distrust for the legislature, and that to tell them where to allocate all the resources on an annual basis. That makes the challenge of reprioritization very, very difficult. It's like tasking somebody with building a house and not giving them a carpenter square. Are you going to expect to have, you know, a house that you want to live in? Well, that's what we're looking at, folks. So, you know, the solution, unfortunately, is either go back to the people, which we just did in Proposal 1, or to go back in the Constitution and modify those provisions.
Got a few folks that have not brought this up in the audience that I think is really important to point to, and that is the whole question of economic development and what our, the condition of our roads, our bridges, have to do with economic development. And I see the director of the Center for Economic Development at Michigan State University over here to my left, Rex Lamore. I'm sure you've had just a vast amount of conversations about what Proposal 1 and what the roads do to impact our economy here in Michigan. Would you mind commenting on that?
The investment in infrastructure is one of the things that the public institutions can do to support private enterprise growth and development. And to the extent that we do not make those infrastructure investments, and it's not just roads, it's internet, it's ports, it's airports, it's a whole gamut of activities that the public sector invests in, then our capacity to support business growth and expansion is limited. And because we are a border state and one that has a substantial investment in cross-border exchanges with Canada, you know, which is an infrastructure issue in and of itself, this does affect us from an economic development perspective. However, in reflecting on that, I think it's also important to note that when we look at how the business community came out on this proposal, we saw some very spotty positions. If I remember correctly, the state chamber did not support the proposal, whereas I think the Detroit Chamber did support the proposal. So the business sector was somewhat hesitant to fully support the proposal. So there's something in their understanding that suggests that this thing has a mixed bag as far as their interests are concerned. So infrastructure investment is one of the limited roles that the public sector can play. The other role that we play is investment in the workforce, the education of the public through the public educational institutions. Those are really the two functions that public institutions can play in economic development. The rest of it's really just fringe, really is. So, you know, this is an important issue for our state. I haven't heard anyone argue for private roads yet, and I was kind of wondering if that toll road issue was going to get surfaced here. No one seems to be suggesting that the private sector should run the roads, and that's certainly an option.
To react to Bill's comment.
Absolutely.
You know, so many legislators come from local government, and I really think they forget their roots because, you know, if you kind of take a look at the pattern of legislators, they would rather push the responsibility down to the locals and not raise taxes at the state level and just put it in the laps of the local governments. And I think that just happens all the time. And I think that's frustrating for the local officials, but it seems to get the state officials sort of off the hook in terms of not being, you know, the tax raisers.
Thank you. Well, obviously this is worthy and requires a, oh, I'm sorry, I did not see. You're going to be our last question of the day.
I am going to be the last. I'll hope to make it worth your time. Okay?
Thank you, Mr. Lehner.
I want to take on the question as to why we're willing to entrust locals to make by initiative tax decisions, but not the state, not the Fayette. I think we got to take a little bit of a look at political history. For the last 30 years in this country, political campaigns, frankly, at times of both parties, have been railing about the fact that government is the enemy. Not that person, not that person, but government is the enemy. Local government has been, by and large, spared in all of that because we know those guys. There's our next door neighbor.
We bowl with them. We this, we that. But state government has been painted, the federal government has been painted as the enemy. Now poor Roger, poor Gilda, has to come in, what, half a dozen weeks and launch a campaign that says, but that was then. This is now. We're not the enemy. I don't think the voters are that... I don't think the voters are that foolish. I think this one was doomed 10 years ago, 5 years ago, because of seeds that were planted that time. And I don't think, and it's why I agree with everybody who has said, let the legislature solve this problem, because I don't think anybody else can.
Thank you. Well, I think Craig said it's back in the lap of the legislature, but I think they all need to hear from people like you, especially the folks who introduce themselves as just citizens. So be sure and have your voices heard. Before we close, and we'll close with a last comment from each of the panelists, I want to give a very hearty thanks to our director, Doug Roberts. Dr. Roberts he's been with the Institute for about 12 years now, and has always been so supportive of these forums. His favorite topic is economic development and this sort of topic, but he's also been open to some really difficult subjects that such as bullying in schools and so forth. And so I think everyone here would like to express their appreciation for your support, Doug. Thank you.
Anne-Marie, thank you very much. It is going to be my last forum as the director, and it's been a privilege to be the director of the Institute for 12 years. And I have a number of quick thank yous that I want to get to, but before I do that, I have to say just a couple of things about a wonderful panel and a couple of things that I, frankly, know a great deal about. The first thing they talked about was there were 11 proposals. I worked on every one. Okay. The first one I began was November of 1972 with Bill Milliken, and he controlled, Bill Milliken was governor, the Democrats controlled. I went all the way up, every single one, up through 1994. Now, the other issue that was raised was the cap. Let me just give a little facts on the cap. I was the one that put an awful lot of the details together for Governor Engler as state treasurer. We didn't write the 5% cap. Okay. The 5% cap was added on the floor of the House by Representative Karen Willard. At that time, the legislature was 55-55, and the amendment was adopted 77-23. How's that for a lot of statistics irrelevant? Okay? But the fact of the matter is, that's what happens when you get a compromise. So, I mean, we didn't add it, but it was added. With that, enough of my life in terms of things that I've seen. I want to thank Anne-Marie for her leadership of the forums. I think the forums hopefully have been timely, hopefully interesting, hopefully useful. I also want to thank some people on my staff, Millie, Kathy, Cindy, Jess. They do a great job of making it work. I want to thank our speakers today and speakers we've had in the past. But most of all, I want to thank you, because without an audience, there'd be no reason to have a forum. So thank you all very much, and my very best for you in the future.
Sometimes someday I'd like to hear what Doug really thinks about all of this. I think he's going to have to write a book in order to be able to really say. Well, let's close this up with the comments from our amazing panelists. I really appreciate your being here today. And I know I have more red eyes than you guys. You're really good. I know that you probably stayed up late and were here. Drove in early, some of you, so thank you for doing that. Randall, do you want to kick this off?
I don't really have any final comments. I'm good.
Well, I think you made some of your comments, and that is we need more transparency, we need more clear information to our voters, and if we're going to put it to the voters and give them the tools they need to make good decisions. Thank you.
You make the assumption that I was up late. Actually, it was a very early night, relatively speaking. Right. We were going down. And I had a lot more later nights during the course of the campaign. But again, if you want your roads fixed, go tell your legislator and go tell them now. I mean, that's the only way it's going to get done, because they're the only ones who can do it.
Okay. Thank you, Raj.
I'm the ditto person. I totally agree with Roger. I think we have to hold our legislators' feet to the fire right now on this, and tell them not to go home until they get a solution.
Thank you.
Ditto. I think the solution is out there. It's not an easy one. It's not that for the last 10 years the legislature hasn't tried to solve this. I don't think deals made at the 11th hour are the best way to solve it either. The counterfactual is, what would have we known if they hadn't thrown this towards us, and would this group still be mired in the same type of debate, and would we be waiting another year and a half until Proposal 1 came up at the next lame duck session? So maybe in a good way, we'll learn from this, and across the street it'll prompt them to find that solution.
Thank you. Thank you. So many lessons. Quoting our governor, I guess it's back to the drawing board. Let's have a round of applause for our panelists, and thank you for being here.